I know in an evening discussion, it's a challenge just to be awake at all. If you need to step up and step out and get some water on your face and wake up, I totally understand that. Don't feel bashful. The good news is here, even though we're talking about John Locke, this dead white European philosopher, the good news is I'm not a philosopher. I am the great-grandson of a barber, the grandson of a baker, and the son of an egg man from Brooklyn. And so we don't do philosophy in the Wakanda family. I'm a historian. And so we're going to try to land the plane as much as we can, keep it practical. Although you do have little handouts in front of you. And it's the one pager that I want you guys to kind of pay attention to, because we're going to look at some quotes together. So I'm going to need some help from you guys. I will ask for volunteers to read those quotes out loud, those sections out loud, and we'll throw it up for discussion kind of as we go. So I'm not going to just ramble on here. I'm going to get some feedback from you guys as we go, and then there'll be Q&A. It's kind of like, you know, my dad was a salesman. He worked for some oil companies in Long Island. He worked as a selling insulation, oil burners. And there was a moment there where one of the guys, one of the customers, he was a minister, Reverend, we'll call him Reverend Johnson, good African-American guy with a great African-American case, and he owed the company, he was behind his payments, and he owed like, I don't know, $300-$400 to the company. And so they sent my dad, the Italian-American guy, out to go collect the money, right? So my dad goes out to Reverend Johnson's house, and he says, you know, Reverend Johnson, you owe us like $300, we gotta get that money sooner rather than later. And he says, oh, don't you worry, Mike, the Lord will provide. The Lord will provide. To which my father replied, I understand that, Reverend, but you're going to have to help him out a little. So I'm going to need you guys to help me out a little tonight with the handout. So do that. Just be ready for that. I won't call on people. I'll ask for volunteers. Well, let's start with this. Let me find my little notes here. And I won't go too long. And then we'll throw it over for discussion. But we are going to discuss along the way. We're in Colonial Virginia. Not a bad place to start, actually. Yeah, it's a great state of Virginia. 1784. And the State General Assembly is trying to pass a bill to collect tax money for all Christian churches. Level a tax that you send to the churches, tax people, send the money to all of the churches in Virginia to promote public morality. That's the idea, right? Taxes. Patrick Henry, that's, you know, give me liberty or give me death, Patrick Henry. He's the author of the bill, right? Well, two important Virginians think this is a bad idea. They see this as an attempt to prop up the Episcopal Church, the Anglican Church in Virginia, with public funds. Thomas Jefferson and James Madison view this tax plan as a slippery slope to religious indoctrination and coercion. They don't like it, but what should they do? Well, Jefferson, who's still in France at the time, he scribbles a note to Madison, December 8th, 1784. Here's a piece of the note. While Mr. Henry lives, while Patrick Henry lives, another bad constitution would be formed and saddled forever on us. What we have to do, I think, is to devoutly pray for his death. That's Jefferson. And they call him a deist. I don't know, just like a deist to me. That's a little, you know, a little mob justice over there, right? Well, Madison chooses a more, much more practical course of action. He drafts a political tract opposing the tax scheme, his memorial and remonstrance against religious assessments, published July 1785. I'm just kind of curious, don't be embarrassed. How many have heard or read that document from Madison, memorial against remonstrance? A couple. Considered really probably the most important religious freedom document in America. Here's Madison, a piece of it. Religion, or the duty which we owe to our Creator and the manner of discharging it, can be directed only by reason and conviction, not by force or violence. Only by reason and conviction, not by force or violence. And those arguments made by Madison and Jefferson, they're going to prevail in this debate in Virginia. They will form the basis for the First Amendment, the strongest protection for religious freedom ever contained in any constitution, I would argue, in the history of mankind. Not bad. Well, what does this achievement have to do with our topic tonight? Let's find out. Imagine, if you will, hundreds of thousands of people, men, women, children, forced to become refugees because of religious intolerance. Imagine governments violating the most basic human rights of their civilian populations for fear that religious zealots will control the levers of power. Imagine ordinary people whose crime is that they belong to the wrong faith community permanently stigmatized, marginalized as second-class citizens. Does that sound familiar? A little familiar? Well, welcome to the catastrophe of late 17th century Europe, supposedly Christian Europe, the world of English philosopher John Locke. Let's get the big picture here. He's born in 1632. Locke's life encompasses one of the most turbulent periods of English history. Faith and fanaticism helped to ignite the English Civil War, condone regicide, you know, lopping off the head of the king, and destabilize the entire restoration project in England, the reestablishment of the crown and the Church of England. Destabilized the whole project. Until his death in 1704, Locke never stopped grappling with the divisive effects of religion on politics and society. Listen to Locke. "I had no sooner found myself in the world," he wrote, "than I perceived myself in a storm which hath lasted almost hitherto." Well, the career of John Locke is central to the story of how the West came out of this storm and defeated two of the most intractable problems of European society. What problems? Militant religion, and political absolutism. In other words, tyranny. Militant religion and political absolutism. In Locke's day in the 17th century, those problems are joined at the hip. They're joined at the hip, as they are, if you think about it, in many parts of the world today. Militant religion, political tyranny, joined together. You know the countries I'm talking about, right, friends? Saudi Arabia. Go down the list. All right. Locke takes on both problems, and he produces political documents that form the canon of the liberal democratic project. The two documents we'll spend some time with tonight. Letter Concerning Toleration, published in 1689. This document ranks as the most important Christian defense of religious liberty in the Western tradition. At least I would argue that it is. The most important Christian defense of religious liberty in our tradition, the Letter Concerning Toleration. His two treatises of government, published in 1690, becomes a great catalyst for revolutionary movements dedicated to what? Human equality, freedom, and government by consent of the governed. That's his, especially his second treatise, as we'll see. Friends, these are transformational documents in the West, influencing not only Locke's native England, sure, and much of the European continent, but also the American Revolution and the American founding. Here's the challenge. We're now in the throes, it seems, in some places, of a debate over whether this tradition, the liberal democratic tradition, is morally legitimate. The liberal democratic project, the lifeblood of the American experiment, is facing fresh storms of criticism from the political left. And again, this is a nonpartisan statement now, friends. From the political left, self-identified democratic socialists, and I'm still trying to get my mind around that phrase, democratic socialists, such as Bernie Sanders, Kamala Harris, Cory Booker, Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, they depict democratic capitalism as an unbroken tale of inequality, injustice, exploitation, and racism. Listen to New York Governor Andrew Cuomo last year. Andrew Cuomo. He says, "We're not going to make America great again. It never was that great." All right. You know, I want to like Andrew Cuomo because he's an Italian-American from New York. I'm an Italian-American from New York. I'd like to like the guy. I want to like the guy. But I kind of want to say, Governor Cuomo, you know, maybe, without being partisan about this, maybe it's time to leave the mansion over there in Albany and get back on the boat and go back to Palermo. Come on, man. We'll see. Hold on. I'll pay his boat fare, if he likes. Look, the leftist complaint against American democracy, this is not new. This has a long pedigree. I understand that. What is surprising, what's really remarkable, is that this critique has found new allies on the right, Christian conservatives. Patrick Deneen, for example, the Catholic political scientist at Notre Dame, has created a stir with his book, Why Liberalism Failed. Why Liberalism Failed. And that book joins Christopher Ferrara's Liberty, the God That Failed, and Rod Dreher's The Benedict Option, in these kind of conservative critiques against liberal democracy. They argue that by transforming the medieval ideas, the pre-modern ideas of freedom and virtue into personal liberation. That's how they see it, personal liberation. Liberal democracy was destined to create new problems, new pathologies, new forms of social breakdown. The source of nearly all of our modern problems, they say, our crass materialism, our relentless secularism, our radical individualism, it can all be traced to the rancid well of Lockean liberalism. Listen to Patrick Deneen. Nearly every one of the promises that were made by the architects and creators of liberalism has been shattered, he says. Liberalism has failed, he says, not because it fell short, but because it was true to itself. True to itself. Well, I think, and we'll unpack it maybe in the Q&A, I think these conservative critics essentially ignore the catastrophic failures of Christendom. In other words, the Catholic medieval project, medieval Christianity. I think they're ignoring the failures of Christendom, the failure to uphold one of the most transformative ideas of the Jewish and the Christian traditions. What idea? The freedom and equality of every human soul. Christendom failed, ultimately, to uphold that idea. That helped to bring about its collapse, I would argue. The attempt to construct a Christian society through coercion, not persuasion, coercion, led to the betrayal of the most basic biblical and humanistic ideals. This is part of the Catholic medieval legacy. So, the liberal project, this liberal democratic project, I would argue, it began as kind of a protest to this failure. It was whispered in the Christian humanism of Erasmus of Rotterdam. It was quickened by Luther's Reformation, advanced by Locke's biblical vision of natural rights, and culminating in James Madison and his religiously rooted republicanism. That's kind of the big picture. I'll say it again. The whole liberal project, I think, is really, in many ways, a Christian response to the failure of Christendom. It's whispered in the humanism of Erasmus. It is quickened by Luther's Reformation. It's advanced by Locke's biblical vision of natural rights, and then finally culminating in Madison's republicanism. That's kind of the big picture. The focus tonight is on Locke, John Locke. Let's get a little bit more of the big picture, and then we'll plunge in, and I'll take it over to our studio audience for a little help, all right? In the political and social chaos of late 17th century Europe, Locke tries to solve an immensely difficult problem. How do we live with our deepest differences? Now, let's try to step in his world, because one of the things that historians like to do is to develop the quality of empathy. Get ourselves, my students and myself, to empathetically move into their world and see what they're going through. We don't have to agree necessarily with everything that's going on, but let's see what's happening and the constraints that they're under. What's happening in 17th century there with Locke? State churches, national churches are taken for granted, right? Government-funded churches, a national church, the church you have to belong to. That's taken for granted. Government repression of unpopular forms of religion is the norm. So they take your property, they fine you, they put you in jail, maybe they execute you. That's the norm in 17th century Europe. Government attempts to enforce religious orthodoxy, whether it's a Catholic or a Protestant country, it's going on in both countries, Catholic and Protestants, both trying to impose their norms on ordinary people. They are failing. This is the big point. In the 17th century, they're trying to impose conformity, and it's failing. It's creating all kinds of social unrest. They are turning ordinary, God-fearing citizens into hypocrites or to criminals, turning neighbor against neighbor. Catholic and Protestant countries, friends, that's the unpleasant news. The advocates of coercion, virtually all of them professed Orthodox Christians, according to Locke, are disgracing the gospel they claim to uphold. This is how Locke sees it. That's his world. Listen to Locke. A sweet religion indeed, he writes, that obliges men to dissemble and to tell lies both to God and man for the salvation of their souls. Like no other thinker before him, Locke makes a case for religious freedom that combines liberal political theory with the reinterpretation of the life and teachings of Jesus. Let me say it again, because it's kind of a big picture. We're going to come back to this point. Like no one else, Locke combines liberal political theory governed by consent of the governed with a reinterpretation of the life and teachings of Jesus. Now, guys, I want somebody, I need a volunteer, to read for us point number one, locked on the second treatise of government, 69, the state of nature. Can I get a volunteer to read that paragraph for us? Anybody? Take it, man. Go.
The state of nature has a law of nature to govern it, which obliges everyone, and reason, which is that law, teaches all mankind who will but consult it, that being all equal and independent, no one ought to harm another in his life, health, liberty, or possession. For men being all the workmanship of one potent and infinitely wise maker, all servants of one sovereign master, sent into the world by his order and about his business, they are his property, whose workmanship they are made to last during his, not another's pleasure.
Thank you, sir. Okay. Guys, just bear down this paragraph for a moment. I want to hear from you now. Tell me what phrases jump off the page. Just think about it for a minute. I'm comfortable with a little bit of silence. What phrases jump off the page, get your attention? Maybe they confuse you. Maybe you agree, disagree, something. Something that jumps off the page. Yeah.
Life, liberty, life, health, liberty, or possession.
Why? No, why? Why is
it? The Constitution says the pursuit of life, liberty, happiness.
Happiness, Jefferson will make it happiness, yeah?
Right.
Locke's not into happiness, he's into life, liberty, and property.
Right.
Or his big three, actually, right? Fair point. What else jumps off the page? Yes, sir.
Following that statement, he also says, for men being all the workmanship of one omnipotent and infinitely wise maker.
Yeah. Why do you like that? Why does that get your attention?
Because that goes back to what you were saying, when he combines the two, the liberal democracy, the liberal with the teachings of Christ.
Okay. Okay. We're getting there. What else? Anything else? Any phrases jump off the page? Take your time. Now let me put it out to you guys. What about that phrase, workmanship? They are the workmanship of one omnipotent and infinitely wise maker. What's that about? What does he mean, workmanship? Why that phrase? Why that word?
This gentleman had a comment.
Oh, well, he's getting at the point that, as in Genesis, that the word will name God's name.
Okay, okay. I can see that. Any other Bible scholars? Workmanship. Where might ring a bell?
Ephesians 2:10. We are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works.
Well done, Bible man. Ephesians 2:10. Locke knows his Bible. He knows his Bible. It's right out of Ephesians 2. We have not talked about this. I'm just stunned at your Bible knowledge. I have to say, Rob, I was stunned. Pleasantly stunned. Yeah, workmanship. How does he unpack it? Further on there, guys, they are his property, whose workmanship they are made to last during his, not another's pleasure. So, we belong to God. It seems to me this is Locke's way of saying to the powers that be who are stealing people's property, oppressing them, taking their lives, he's saying, wait a minute, they're God's property. They're not your property. Get your hands off. They're God's property. It's a punch in the face to the conventional understanding. Here's the king. Here's the hierarchy. Here's the establishment. Everybody else is just kind of subject to them at their disposal. Locke is saying, no. No. And it's a biblical, it's something like a biblical anthropology, isn't it? The view of the human person. It's kind of how he begins some of this business here, guys. Worth thinking about. Well, as a laying the groundwork. Okay. Still getting this big picture here. This doctrine of political equality, which is suggested here in the first point in the second treatise, this doctrine of political equality, it is invigorated by a gospel of divine mercy, as we're going to see. That's the big picture. Just putting that out there as a kind of, okay, here's an anthropology we're seeing in Locke. In the second treatise. I'm going to spend most of our time on the letter on toleration. But that's part of his anthropology. Now, let's remember again the immediate historical context. The crisis at hand when Locke writes his famous letter. It's published in 1689, but he writes it in 1685. A little delay. In 1685, Locke is in the Netherlands. He's living as a political exile because he's implicated in a failed plot to kill the English king. Long story short, He's hiding out in the Netherlands, a pretty tolerant society even then, right? Now, in October of 1685, weeks, just a few weeks before Locke starts writing his letter on toleration, Louis XIV, the Catholic monarch, he negates, he invalidates, he abolishes his Edict of Nantes. I don't expect people necessarily to know that. Everybody remember what the Edict of Nantes was in France? An act of toleration. Tolerating who? Tolerating the Protestant believers or the Huguenots in France. A measure of toleration in this Catholic country. This Edict of Nantes, this experiment, he ends it in 1685 in October. Abolishes it. So the toleration is gone. And now, Protestants in Catholic France, they are forbidden to worship in public or in private under any pretext whatever. All ministers now face a choice in 1685. Convert to Catholicism or leave the country in a fortnight. You got 2 weeks to get out. Anyone remaining in court preaching in a Protestant church will be arrested, sent to prison, maybe executed. Churches are demolished. Private Protestant schools shut down. In the first wave of persecution, at least, we think, 200,000 Protestants flee the country. They go to England, they go to Denmark, they go to South Africa, some to North America, but a lot of them wind up in Holland, in the Netherlands, where Locke is, at that moment in time, because of its economic vibrancy, because of its reputation for toleration in Netherlands, where Locke is. He meets them, he befriends some of them, a number of them, becomes correspondent. In other words, he understands what's going on. He's in the thick of this thing, this persecution. So, the crisis now in 1685 with Locke, well, it's kind of international. They got problems in England with the coercion going on in England, on the Church of England. We got problems now in Catholic France. Protestant country in England, Catholic country in France, religious persecution in both countries. It's an international problem. It defies any easy political solution. No quick legislative fix. Romp will understand this. H.R. 347 ain't going to cut it. There's no bill you can pass to solve this problem. It's a huge cultural problem. So what Locke is up against is, all right, I need to develop, he's thinking to himself, it seems to me, as you're reading, I need a principled, nonpartisan defense of religious freedom that everybody can understand, whether you're a committed Christian or not. That's what he's trying to develop, I think, with his letter on toleration. A principled, nonpartisan defense of religious freedom. As broadly, morally based as possible. So, what are some of Locke's core arguments? And we'll continue to unpack these quotes here together. What are his core arguments that I think have relevance for us today? First, because the act of faith is so important, it has to be left to individual choice. The act of faith is so important, it has to be left to individual choice. It must be the product of a sincere heart and mind, sincerity. Locke owned scores of books on theology, sermon collections that dealt with themes of sin, heaven and hell, judgment. Locke believed in the immortality of the soul and the hope of eternal life and a day of judgment. Can somebody read for us paragraph 4 over there, under the letter of toleration? Paragraph 4. Go, man.
Every man has an immortal soul capable of eternal happiness or misery, whose happiness depending upon his believing and doing those things in this life, which are necessary to the obtaining of God's favor.
We see this comment, this kind of thought from Locke again and again and again in his many writings on toleration over the decades. He comes back to this point again and again. The doctrine of eternal life, the importance of it, becomes a kind of battering ram for Locke to pummel the false motives, from his perspective, the false motives of the advocates of coercion. They betray their ambition, he says, and show that what they desire is temporal dominion. In other words, the will to power. Religion is a cloak for the will to power. That's what he's saying, because this issue of eternal life is so important. It is not possible, according to Locke, to believe or do the things that God requires without a good conscience. Let me just ask you guys a question, because it's a hugely important theme. I'm always kind of curious how it's all coming out here, if it's a Christian college or not. Conscience. How do you guys understand conscience? How would you define conscience? What is it? Or what do you associate with conscience? Could be a free association or a definition. Anything. Floor is open. Yeah.
The Imago Dei.
Imago Dei. Keep talking.
So if you say that man is men are created in the image of God, then we would have some sense from that Imago Dei of what is right and wrong, what's according to God's law and what's not.
Okay, image of God leaves us with some sense of morality, some imprint of morality.
And if you look at scripture and, you know, the verses that say that men are without excuse, that it's plain in from what they can see that God exists, that he's worthy of our complete, you know, surrender, basically.
Okay, men are without excuse, there's some accountability, moral, anything else on this? What would I add to that? Conscience.
Conscience is the most sacred of all man's property.
Why?
Because no man can take it from you.
No man can take it from you. Conscience? Anything else we can add to that? Conscience. We'll unpack it a little bit more, but just hold on to that thought. Conscience. Paragraph 5. Can somebody refer to paragraph 5? Although the magistrate's opinion. Yeah.
Although the magistrate's opinion in religion be sound, and the way he appoints be truly evangelical, yet if I be not thoroughly persuaded thereof in my own mind, there will be no safety for me in following it. No way whatsoever that I shall walk in against the dictates of my conscience will ever bring me to the mansions of the blessed. I may grow rich by an art that I take not delight in. I may be cured by some diseases, by remedies that I have not faith in. But I cannot be saved by religion that I distrust and by worship that I abhor. Faith only and inward sincerity are the things that procure acceptance with God.
Thank you so much. Okay, let's support this for more friends. I'll put the question to you again. Phrases that jump off the page, anything stand out to you? Do you agree with how Locke is formulating this? This idea of faith, what it is, sincerity, any thoughts? Phrases that jump off the page.
The echo I hear is sola fide.
You're talking about
faith alone, right? It's one of the tenets of the Protestant Reformation. And he's making this appeal to this understanding that faith alone is necessary and sufficient for salvation. And it's faith, not compellence.
What kind of faith? How would you describe? What are the qualities you think would lock here or maybe elsewhere? What's
it's involuntary. It's an inherently voluntary.
It's voluntary. It's voluntary. It's uncoerced faith. I'll buy that. Uncoerced faith. Anything else on this paper stands out to you? His analogies here. The imagery he's using. In no way whatsoever that I shall walk in against the dictates of my conscience will ever bring me to the mansions of the blessed. There's that conscience thing again. Conscience. He links conscience to saving faith, doesn't he? Clear conscience, authentic conscience to saving faith. We can agree or disagree with Locke's formulation on this, but this is his argument. Which is going to inform the founders. Other thoughts on this? One more question. Anything stand out? Yeah.
I liked when it said I cannot be saved by a religion that I distrust and by a worship that I abhor.
Yeah.
That makes perfect sense. Like, if you don't, like you said about the conscience, if you don't believe it, if you don't have the conscience to, like, accept that,
yes.
Obviously you're not going to have that kind of faith. You're not going to
yes.
have the faith if you don't trust it.
Yes. A terrific point, and it seems so obvious maybe to us now in the 21st century, but what he's saying here is controversial. It's just controversial in the 17th century. So he's making that point. All right. Sincerity. Okay, second. That first point again, just to emphasize here, the act of faith, it's so important. The stakes are so high. Eternal salvation. Faith has to be genuine, has to be sincere, or it ain't going to help us. It's not going to lead us to the mansions of the blessed. Right? Second point. Locke appeals to every person's capacity to pursue the truth about God for himself or herself. Let me say it again. He appeals to every person's capacity and obligation, actually, to pursue the truth about God for himself or herself. I think Locke articulates a belief in what I would call the democratic conscience. The democratic conscience, the God-given ability to seek, to understand, and to confirm within one's conscience the truths about God necessary for salvation. Let me say it again, this democratic conscience. It's the God-given ability, not just on our own. God-given capacity to seek, understand, and confirm within our conscience the truths about God necessary for salvation. Can somebody read first paragraph 3, backtrack over there, Essay concerning human understanding, 689, paragraph 3, somebody.
He that believes without having any reason for believing may be in love with his own fancies, but neither seeks truth as he ought, nor pays the obedience due to his maker, who would have him use those discerning faculties he has given him to keep him out of mistake and error.
Thank you so much. All right, pause on that little sentence, little paragraph for a moment in his essay in Human Understanding, published 1689. What do you make of that? Anything stand out to you about that that claim, that assertion? What is he saying there? Put it in your own words. What's Locke saying there at point 3?
He's saying that true faith is determined internally. It's not determined by your actions, because you can be compelled to act in a certain way, but you won't necessarily be compelled to believe what you
have. There's something deeply internal and personal about this. What else? This whole idea of truth. What's Locke's take on this pursuit of truth, man? Anybody?
Needs to be an intelligent faith.
Yes, I can have the right answer for the wrong reason or for no reason.
Say it again?
I can have the right answer, but I might have it for the wrong reason or no reason.
Yeah.
It might just be a question.
Yeah.
I can, of course, have the wrong answer.
What I love about this is Locke's insistence that, you know, we have to seek the truth. We have an obligation to seek out the truth about God. If you don't seek it, and the obedience that we owe to God, well, you're in deep trouble. How are you going to stay out of error? We have an obligation to seek out truth, and we have the capacity. That's what he assumes. Because this is just an open-ended statement. He's not writing it for the kings and the royalty or the clergy. This is an open-ended statement. Everybody has this obligation and capacity to seek truth. It's the universal character of the conscience, the democratic conscience. That's why I use the word democratic. It's universal. Everybody has the capacity, according to Locke. In other words, there's no hint of any distinction among individuals in their basic competence to discern moral and spiritual truth, male or female, prince or pauper. You have the basic capacity, according to Locke, to seek out and to discover the truth you need to find peace with God. The prince has no advantage over the pauper. Take a look at paragraph 5. Can you read paragraph 5 for us? Let's drive home this point. Paragraph 5. Can I volunteer to read? Paragraph 5. How are we doing there at 7:40 in the evening? Everybody holding together over there? I can't fall asleep because I'm standing up. I haven't learned how to fall asleep while standing up. And I have coffee in my hand. How are you guys doing over there? All right? Okay. Paragraph 5. Somebody. A brave soul. Paragraph 5. Can you read aloud for us?
I think we just read 5.
Oh, I'm sorry. Read 5. I'm sorry. Lacani is obviously asleep at the wheel. We read 5. What I need now is paragraph 3. Thank you very much. Just look at him, needs more coffee. I need to, maybe read paragraph 3. We're covering all this bunch of ground. This is just terrific. Lovely. We'll just keep moving on then. Here's the thing I want you guys to think about. Since I clearly, is that decaf coffee? What are you doing? Why don't you serve me a bowl of plastic fruit while you're at it? Is that decaf coffee? The question I want to ask you guys now, then, okay, think about 17th century Europe. And what Locke is now saying, he's saying this democratic conscience thing, everybody has it, everybody has the capacity. Think about 17th century Europe. Why might that be so radical? Step back into his world. Why might that be so controversial from what you know about 17th century Europe?
Well, he's saying that the church doesn't have authority.
He's challenging authority. He's challenging religious authorities to make these decisions for you. Absolutely right. Anything else?
He's also challenging political authority. Like, these people, you aren't making Christians out of. These people aren't Catholic because you're calling them Catholic. These people aren't Protestant because you're calling them Protestant.
Yeah.
He's sort of sticking it to the man. Like,
yeah.
Well, these people, you might think that you're making them Christian. You might think that these are all Catholics, but they're Catholic by deed, not by heart. They're Protestant by deed, not by heart.
Something internal has not happened, right? The external isn't going to cut. Something authentic internally has to happen. Great point. Anything else? Yeah.
Women don't have rights, so he's saying that women are equally capable.
Bingo. Bingo. This is across genders. Locke's not saying that the men have this capacity. Men and women have this obligation. pursue and capacity to pursue truth. That's kind of a big deal in the 17th century. But even the bigger deal, I think, how countercultural this idea is, if you occupy a lower social order, you know, you're a peasant, you're a cobbler, whatever you are, this implies a diminished capacity to grasp religious truth. You need the help and guidance of your superiors, political and religious superiors. They'll guide you into the truth. You know, the nursing mothers and nursing fathers of the church, they're going to help you out over here. You can't just decide this on your own. And there's no hint of that with Locke. Every person has the obligation, the capacity to seek the truth. He takes this, hierarchy, the whole idea of hierarchy, he just takes it to the woodshed. To the woodshed. Okay. The democratic conscience. This is a thoroughly, radically egalitarian view of human capacities. It's radical stuff, friends. Okay, second point. Third point. Locke interprets the moral, the life and teachings of Jesus as an unambiguous defense of religious freedom. Locke interprets the life and teachings of Jesus as an unambiguous defense of religious freedom. Orthodoxy is important. Creeds are important. Liturgy, church attendance, those are all important, Locke would acknowledge. But they're not the most important things. Let anyone ever have so true a claim to all of these things, he says. But if he's destitute of charity, meekness, and goodwill in general towards all mankind, even to those who are not Christians, he's certainly yet short of being a true Christian himself, he says. Before Locke makes his famous argument for the separation of church and state, which is where he's going on the letter on toleration, the actual institutional separation of church and state, that's his big point in the letter, one of the big points. He first appeals to the character of the Christian in the person of Jesus. Now I've got my coffee kicking in. Can I get a volunteer for point number eight? Point number eight, if like the captain. Yeah, go.
If, like the captain of our salvation, they sincerely desired the good of souls, they would tread in the steps and follow the perfect example of the Prince of Peace, who sent out his soldiers to the subduing of nations and gathering them into his church, not armed with the sword or other instruments of force, but prepared them with the gospel of peace and with the exemplary holiness of their conversion.
Conversation.
This is his method.
Thank you so much for that. Okay, let's bear down this paragraph for a few moments, guys. Well, there's a lot here. Different phrases, different analogies, allusions and all. What stands out to you? What particularly stands out to you? A phrase, a thought? You're not sure what he's talking about? This is a good time to throw it out here for discussion. Let's take a few minutes with this, because this is a huge theme for Locke, it seems to me. It's a huge theme. He's not exactly quoting the Bible, at least not clearly, directly. We've got these sort of biblical allusions, don't we? What do you make of it? What stands out? The floor is open. Yeah.
Perhaps this is like a different time period. I'm not sure, but I thought of the Crusades. Mm-hmm. How, like, the Pope sent his people to, like, literally convert people by force.
Yeah.
Like, then that's not how you're going to convert somebody.
Yeah.
Obviously, they're going to convert because they don't want to die.
Yeah.
So I think, like, the way that he says, like, not armed with swords or other instruments of force, but prepared for the gospel of peace.
Yeah, yeah. I think you're right. I think he has probably both the Crusades and perhaps the Inquisition both in mind. That's probably in his mind. I mean, he's much closer to that episode in Christian history than we. And that stuff is still pretty fresh for them. The religious wars of the 17th century in Europe that bloodied the continent, that's pretty fresh if you're in the 17th century, right? That's pretty fresh. What else? Somebody else had a hand right over here. Other phrases that stand out to you guys. Yes?
Not necessarily a phrase, but just when the first part saying, if like the captain of our salvation, they sincerely desire the good of our souls.
Yeah.
You know, he's basically saying, like, if you guys really cared about the common person, then you wouldn't be, why aren't you following the example that Christ gave us?
Yeah.
He gave us the perfect example, not by coercion, but by freedom.
Yep. Captain of our salvation, Bible scholars out there, where's that come from? Rob? Silence? You can talk in a moment. Bible scholars out there, King James Version in particular? Captain of our salvation.
Yeah, he said it actually. In the story of Joshua, he was visited by the captain of the Lord's armies.
Oh, I thought about Joshua. Anybody else? Captain of our salvation, Rob, you want to weigh in?
I think it's from Hebrews.
Oh, Rob, you're on a roll here, brother. Go. You're on a roll, man.
You can see the glow just if you can, you need hospitalization.
It's like Bible Jeopardy over here for this guy. The phrase captain of our salvation, friends, this was a biblical idiom from Hebrews 2, verse 10 in the King James. Here's how the King James reads. For it became him for whom are all things, and by whom are all things, in bringing many sons unto glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through suffering. You read the sermons of the period, that phrase is in the air. Captain of our salvation. Locke appeals to the redemptive mission of Jesus on the cross. And then he argues that his disciples followed his example by the exemplary holiness of their conversation. What in the world does he mean by that? The exemplary holiness of their conversation. What's that say to you? Exemplary holiness. That's the example they're setting. That's how they're winning people over to the faith. The exemplary holiness of their conversation. What in the world is he talking about? Put it in English. Take a stab at it. We're all friends here. Nothing to lose. Yeah.
Is this type of the way that he emphasizes reason, where he thinks that someone who's been internally changed will be able to be, or other people will be able to reasonably notice that there's something different about them?
Yes.
Because he thinks that they can be convinced by reason.
By reason. Not by thinking. By reason. Who else on this? Exemplary holiness of their conversation. In other words, dialogue. They're talking. They're debating. Persuasion. That's what he means. Persuasion. Think about the conversation of the two disciples on the road to Emmaus, if you know that story, at the end of Luke, and the stranger Jesus appears alongside, and they're in a conversation, apparently for the afternoon, about the risen Jesus. They're talking. It's probably, I think it's the first conversion story, really, in the resurrection accounts. They're converted to the faith through a conversation, the exemplary holiness of their conversation. Locke knows his Bible, and he seems to know something about the character of Jesus. Well, in Locke's political theology, there is an intimate connection between the meaning of the Christian gospel and the spirit of charity, generosity toward others, even toward those with unorthodox views. Here's how Locke put it. Jesus opened the kingdom of heaven to all equally who believed in him, he writes, without any the least distinction of nation, blood, profession, or religion. Gates of heaven opened equally to all, he says. This is the moral fulcrum for reform for Locke. God's indiscriminate love toward his enemies embodied in the sacrificial death of Jesus on behalf of sinners. This demands that his followers show kindness and compassion toward their adversaries. Nay, Locke wrote, God himself will not save men against their wills. See what he's saying. The example of Jesus, the example of the apostles. Faith can't be coerced. We persuade or we don't. So to recap, and we'll keep plotting on here, guys. Number one, the act of faith must be genuine, based on individual conscience before God. Two, every person has the ability to discern the truths necessary for peace with God, the democratic conscience. Three, not even God himself will violate the conscience of the individual. A truth embodied in the life and teachings of Jesus. Let me give you one little biblical example, a little parenthetical, guys, which came into my mind recently, worth saying. You know, where's the example here? When the rich young man who comes to Jesus and asks, you know, what must I do to be saved? Right? It's an amazing moment of the Gospels in my mind. It's an absolutely amazing, remarkable, fearsome moment. He comes to Jesus and asks him, what must I do to be saved? Jesus says, well, sell everything you have and then come follow me. And what does the rich young man do, Bible scholars in our ranks? What's that?
He tells them, go away sadly. He leaves.
He leaves. He leaves. He turns away sadly because?
He couldn't do that.
He had great wealth and his mind was too costly. And what does Jesus do? Well, we can tell from the narrative. here's something awesome. Jesus himself, God in human form, looks into the eyes of another human being and calls him to follow him, to join him on the adventure of a lifetime. He's called by Jesus more personally than any of us have ever been called. And what does he do? The man turns away. Misses out on the opportunity of a lifetime. Well, that's something about the nature of faith. It has to be chosen. We choose. We have to respond to the call, and he will compel. That's Locke's understanding of things. God himself will not save men against their wills. There's a basis here, I think, ultimately, for religious freedom. Well, what are the political implications of Locke's Christian appeal? The political implications now for his appeal for religious freedom. In the Letter on Toleration, as well as the Second Treatise, the responsibility of the political authority, the government, is to protect life, liberty, and property of its citizens. Life, liberty, and property. Not life, liberty, and happiness. That's a Jeffersonian thing. Life, liberty, and property of its citizens. But it has to do so with justice, according to Locke, with an equal and indiscriminate hand toward all members of the commonwealth, of the society. Otherwise, that government ceases to be legitimate, according to Locke. The theme of impartial justice. And I know we're struggling with that in a society, you know, now America hasn't fully emerged from all this. Impartial justice for all religious believers based on what? The natural equality of every human being, all made in his workmanship, right? The workmanship of God. This is one of the moral triumphs, I think, of Locke's Letter on Toleration. Can somebody read for us paragraph 9, the duty of the magistrate? Paragraph 9, ladies in the back, yeah? Looking kind of eager over there, yeah? What do you think? Ladies in the shadows, go ahead.
Sure. It is the duty of the civil magistrate, by the impartial execution of equal laws, to secure unto all the people in general, and to every one of his subjects in particular, the just possession of these things that belong to this life.
Thank you so much. Comments on this, anybody? Comments on this particular phrase? A lot here, think about it. Pretty powerful. The job of the civil, meaning the political authority, the government. What's the job of the government?
To protect the rights of the individual.
Yes, and?
To be impartial in doing so.
Impartial. This whole idea of equal justice under law, which we just kind of take for granted. And I know we struggle with this country still. It's not a perfect union. But it is certainly a constitutional principle here in the States. Equal justice under the law. The thing, and here's the other thing, the things belonging to this life. The things belonging to this life. In other words, life, liberty, property, the material stuff, not the religious stuff. That's not the job of the state, according to Locke. The core function of government, it must not concern itself with the salvation of souls. That's the job of the faith community. This is radical stuff, friends, for 1685. Everybody assumes in the 17th century, that the goal of government is to really be involved in these religious matters, matters of the soul. Defend the Orthodox faith. Promote the religious beliefs of the established church. Everybody assumes that throughout Europe. And Locke says, no, that's not the job of the government. The government's job is to protect life, liberty, property, period. And get out of the religion business. That's what he's saying at the end of the day. Impartial execution of equal laws. In words that must have stunned his contemporaries, Locke proclaims that Christian morality demands that all people, enjoy the same degree of religious freedom and protection of their civil rights, and here's the phrase, regardless of their religious beliefs. Regardless of their religious beliefs. Somebody read first paragraph 10, but those whose doctrine is peaceable. Paragraph 10, kind of climax to this letter in so many ways. Yes, take it.
But those whose doctrine is peaceable and whose manners are pure and blameless ought to be upon equal terms with their fellow subjects. Thus, if solemn assemblies, observations of festivals, public worship be permitted to any one sort of professors, all these things ought to be permitted to the Presbyterians, Independents, Anabaptists, Arminians, Quakers, and others with the same liberty. Nay, if we may speak openly, speak the truth, and as becomes one man to another, neither pagan nor Muslim nor Jew ought to be excluded from the civil rights of the commonwealth because of his religion. The gospel commands no such thing.
Thank you so much. All right, let's bear down the paragraph. And remember the time period now, the 1680s, Europe. why might this summary of Locke's vision for the political community he has in mind, why might this be somewhat controversial? The floor is open. There's not just one single reason here, friends. There's several reasons this thing was controversial in the 1680s, yeah.
I mean, I think that it's radical enough for him to try and extend it to all of these different sects of Christianity.
Yeah.
So the fact that he would take it outside is doubly radical, doubly kind of unheard of, that he would extend it to other religions.
Yes, and the others he has in mind, why might they be particularly, do you think, at this moment in time, in the 1680s, why they might be particularly troublesome? Any thoughts? Keep talking. You're on it.
Basically, the Muslim world was expanding, and they were conquering more and more land, and so that's why he was tolerant.
Tolerant of the Muslims. Great point. 1685. What happened in 1683?
Siege of Vienna.
Siege of Vienna. We barely beat back. We, the Christian nations of Europe, barely defeated the Muslim armies, the Turkish Muslim armies at Vienna. Imagine the anti-Muslim sentiment in the air just a couple of years later. You think we got troubles? No. No. And Locke puts them on the list of people who deserve equal justice under the law. Put the Muslims aside for a minute. Any pagans in the room? Locke is your guy, if you're a pagan. Pagans are on the list. You know, pagan, and what he means by pagans, it's not a put-down. He means those who probably, it might be into, I don't know, some kind of polytheism or something else, or, you know, deism, something. Not Orthodox Christianity when he says pagan. Pagans are on the list. And who else is on the list? Well, let's look at that list for a moment. Anabaptists, Quakers. You know, if you're an Anabaptist or a Quaker, you know where you are in the 1680s, if you're in Great Britain or elsewhere in Europe? You're on the run, or you're in prison, or you're dead. These are the most despised religious minorities in Europe in the 1680s. And they're all on his list of people who deserve equal justice under the law. And let's not forget the Jews. France is another topic for another day. But the anti-Semitism in Europe, European Christianity, Protestant and Catholic both. This is, Paul Johnson uses the phrase, a disease of the mind, anti-Semitism. A disease of the mind. And that disease is rampant. Reasons I can't understand and discern. But the anti-Semitism in Europe is rampant. It's rampant in Locke's day, and they make the list. Jews make the list of equal protection under the law. This is radical stuff. Yeah.
For John Locke, what was his moral baseline that the government should operate out of if it's not combined with the church?
That's a terrific question, because the one group he won't give toleration to, which I think is a partial answer to your question, no toleration for atheists. And now you might argue this is Locke being inconsistent, and that's it. You can make that case. No toleration for atheists. Almost no one in his day thinks atheists should be tolerated. Why? According to Locke, there's a couple of reasons. They just can't be trusted to uphold public morality. That's his view. The belief in God, according to Locke, should be so obvious there's something wrong with those who insist upon atheism. And remember, it's a very oath-driven society. People are making oaths all the time. Well, who are the atheists swearing to? You know? That's a problem. I think I'm going to paraphrase this. It's in the letter on toleration. He says the lack of belief in God, if only in thought, dissolves all. Dissolves all. And what he meant by that was the civic obligations we have to one another. Take away belief in God, and morality goes out the window. That's his big fear. I'm not defending or criticizing it. That's his view. We might just say parenthetically that the political application of atheism in the 20th century has pretty unhappy results when we consider communism, Soviet communism, and fascism, which are violently atheistic ideologies, pagan ideologies. So I'm not necessarily agreeing with Locke on this in terms of toleration, but that's where he's coming from. So in other words, government needs to have some kind of morality grounded, probably something in monotheism. At the end of the day. Does that help?
Yes.
But you want to follow up, or is that?
That's the answer.
Great question. Other thoughts on this particular paragraph, guys? Anything else? I don't want to foreclose discussion on it. The gospel commands no such thing. He just brings the gospel back in there again. Without quoting a verse, he just insists the gospel commands no such thing, persecution of people. Just says it. Yeah.
I'm just curious. I'm without yours, but I've got this one. Does your paragraph include the preamble which says If anything, in a religious meeting, which is seditious and contrary to public peace,
yeah.
it is to be punished in the same manner as anything else.
That's if I remember right, that is correct in the letter. If you're working against, if you're trying to undermine the government, if you're trying to overthrow the government, if you're seditious, hey, we're not going to tolerate that.
So he's making a distinction. I've got, I can go to the mosque, but if in the mosque what you're preaching is something seditious,
yeah.
then it's not because
it's
of
not
your
exactly.
religion, it's because of your sedition.
That's exactly right. That's a great point, because Locke also, I believe, extends toleration to Catholics. My Catholic friends don't think he does. They're not listed in this list. I think in the letter, and we can have a good debate about this, I think in the letter, Locke says pretty clearly, look, if a guy wants to if people want to worship in the Roman way, he says, meaning believing in the transubstantiation, what's that to us? He's not worried about that. He's worried about sedition. Catholics are associated
with the same concern over John F. Kennedy and everyone else in the early American running, that there would be loyalty to someone
yeah.
above.
That's right.
And that's where I think
that's
so
the tension.
I agree that the type of worship wouldn't be the problem. It's the loyalty.
It's the loyalty, ultimate loyalty. And you're absolutely right. And the challenge then is you do have Catholic popes calling for the overthrow of Protestant kings. Don't be loyal to these guys. So that's in the air. And let's be to your point, be fair to your point. There's a lot of anti-Catholic bigotry in England. There's no question about it. In the 1680s, they're worried about a papal takeover. That's in the air.
Bloody Mary wasn't that long ago.
So, but the interesting point is that Locke even goes to the trouble of saying in the letter, if you want to worship in the Roman way, worship in the Roman way, but you got to be loyal to the political authority, to qualify them all. That's the qualification. The Constitution is not a suicide pact, as we might say in the States, right? If you're trying to overthrow the government, we don't have toleration for that. But if you're worshiping, according to the law, you're respecting people's rights, you're respecting people's law, worship away, man, worship away. Okay, radical stuff, friends. Won't beat the point home too much. Anyway, what's Locke's ultimate political aim? He kind of says it for us in the letter, and I love it as a historian. I love it when the author just kind of lays out for you what he thinks the whole point of it is. Here's how he phrases it. The sum of all we drive at is that every man enjoy the same rights that are granted to others. The sum of all we drive at is that every man enjoy the same rights that are granted to others. He means men and women. Well, there it is. It's irrespective of religious belief. Equal justice under the law, regardless of religious creed. The civic ethos for which Locke pleads is none other than this, that people treat their fellow citizens as they themselves wish to be treated, with equity, especially in matters of faith. Now, friends, you don't have to be a Bible scholar to know this. What is this except the political application of the golden rule? It's the political application of the golden rule. Treat others as you want to be treated. That's what he's doing here, it seems to me. Might seem so, I don't know, naive or simplistic, but it's pretty powerful stuff, and it's actually applied. Unlike many modern thinkers, for Locke, religion is not the main cause of social unrest. It doesn't have to be, according to Locke. Religion does not have to be the cause of social unrest. Rather, it is government's abusive treatment of religious minorities that turns citizens into lawbreakers. The loss of a person's natural rights, take away his property and all the rest of it, that's what leads him into the company of conspirators. For Locke, the problem is actually the decline of authentic religion, the decline of religion, a spiritual corruption aided and abetted by a culture of coercion. The problem isn't religion. The problem is a lack of genuine Christian belief, tolerance, love, charity. It's the decline of that that's the problem for Locke. And what are the results? The Europe of Locke's day is a persecuting society. Can somebody read for us paragraph 11 to drive home this point? Paragraph 11, anybody? Is still awake out there.
It is not the diversity of opinions which cannot be avoided, but a refusal of toleration to those that are of different opinions, which might have been granted, that has produced all the bustles and wars that have been in the Christian world. Upon account of religion, no peace and security, no, not so much as common friendship, can ever be established or preserved amongst men, so long as this opinion prevails that religion is to be propagated by force of arms.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Guys, it's hard to overstate how radical this is in 1680, because the prevailing view is You know, the problem, the great source of social unrest is all these diverse religious beliefs creeping out of the woodwork, making their claims, causing their mischief. We've got to have one religion, you know, one national state religion. That's how you get unity, you know, national unity, one religion, everybody's on board. Everybody goes to the national church. That's how you hold things together. And anything else is just going to cause social division. Locke is saying, no, religious pluralism, diversity can be a source of social strength if we have the principle of equal justice under the law. Why? Because everybody then is invested in the thing. You're invested in the system. You're invested in the success of the system. If you genuinely believe, you're going to be treated like everybody else. So you want the system to succeed, right? Equal justice under the law. That's Locke's idea. So, for Locke, the reconstruction of Christianity into a tolerant and egalitarian religion, this will help the, create the conditions for a tolerant society. In other words, there's got to be change at the church level, at the theological level, before you have political change. I think that's how Locke's approaching this. We've got to get to the pastors, to the theologians. We've got to get them to change what they're preaching from the pulpit about religious freedom and toleration. And then we'll have political change. Locke's political vision, which is what? A society rooted in the concept of equal justice under the law. For him, religious pluralism now can be a source of social strength. He dares to imagine a political community more tolerant, more diverse, more genuinely humane than anything Christian Europe would produce for generations. Friends, we're getting close to the heart of the genius of the American experiment. Right? Equal justice under the law, separation of church and state. Government doesn't play favorites when it comes to religious. If there's one source of America's stability, despite its diversity, its incredible ethnic and religious diversity, if there's one explanation for our stability, our prosperity, it's probably this. Equal justice under law, regardless of religious belief. No sectarian wars on the American continent, unlike our European friends. No sectarian wars. Yeah, there's tension. I understand that. Not perfect. But no bloody religious wars, equal justice under the law, the most welcoming place for religious minorities in the world. I want to say to Governor Cuomo, man, wake up, man. Come on, not bad. Not bad, right? So, could something like this take root? Let's just take it to the current day. Could something like this take root in Muslim societies? Muslim societies now. There are hopeful signs. Hopeful. So, take the remarkable influence of Pakistan's Malala Yousafzai. You guys know about Malala a little bit? You followed her a little bit? This teenager shot in the head by the Taliban now, well, about a decade ago now. Shot in the head by the Taliban for a crusade to allow women to go to school. That was her crime. Trying to get women to go to school in Pakistan. Shot in the head by the Taliban. She survives. And she refuses to remain silent about women's rights. She gets the Nobel Peace Prize in 2014. Malala has attracted millions of supporters to her cause. It's a spiritual campaign, if you listen to her, a spiritual campaign rooted in a belief in the natural equality of every human being. Listen to Malala on this point in a speech before the United Nations. There are hundreds of human rights activists and social workers who are not only speaking for their rights, but who are struggling to achieve their goal of peace, education, and equality. She tells this spellbound audience at the UN. And then she says this. So here I stand, one girl among many. Here I stand, one girl among many, I tell you. There's a young lady, makes me want to be a braver man. I don't know about you guys back there. I see her and I just want to be a braver man. Well, the success of her movement is, of course, not assured. Because writing constitutions committed to political equality and human rights, including the rights of conscience in matters of faith. This is not an easy task in the Muslim world. I know that. I'm not naive about it. Like European Christianity, on the eve of the Enlightenment, the Islamic community must find a religious justification for political reform. Because this clearly is what Locke has given us. A religious justification for political reform. The Islamic world has to find that. I don't know if they can. I don't know. It's an open question. But we can't forget that the West, yes, our West, endured a long season of religious violence and political absolutism There was nothing inevitable about the conversion of European society from despotism to liberal democracy. Many actors played a role in this drama, but few were as consequential as John Locke. No one reflected more carefully on the nature of Christian faith and its relationship to political societies. No one else produced works that became so transformational in the debates over church and state, freedom and tyranny. Beneath Locke's plea for a more just and tolerant society, I think, flowed a river of rage, of fierce resentment at the hypocrisy and violence which had scandalized the Christian church, both Catholic and Protestant. Can someone read paragraph 12 for us on this point?
Toleration of those that differ from others in matters of religion is so agreeable to the gospel of Jesus Christ and the genuine reason of mankind that it seems monstrous for men to be so blind as not to perceive the necessity and advantage of it in so clear a light.
Thank you, sir. And before we bring this to a close and go to Q&A, just on paragraph 12, what stands out to you? The arguments, the point that he's making. What stands out? The contrast, the phrases, what stands out? Attentive readers.
Necessity.
Why? Why is it powerful?
Because
he capitalizes it. He thinks it's important too.
It is. I think it becomes essential to address each one's needs, regardless of background or religious background,
yes.
Perhaps.
Yes. Yes. Necessity.
It's essential.
Obligation. We have to do this. What else? Great point. What else? How about this phrase, ladies and gentlemen, attentive readers? It's so agreeable to the gospel of Jesus Christ and the genuine reason of mankind. Reason and revelation. They're not in conflict on this point, according to Locke. Reason and revelation agree, according to Locke. They perfectly agree. He's just saying, wake up. For those of you who've seen that the great movie, which one is it? Back to the Future. Wake up, McFly. You know, reason and revelation. They agree, according to Locke. So, his strategy is to reinterpret the Christian faith, to leverage the moral authority of Jesus in order to instigate a massive restructuring of political and ecclesiastical life. Let me say that one again, because it's a big point. I think Locke's strategy, which a lot of scholars just miss it, I think he's trying to leverage the moral authority of Jesus to instigate a massive restructuring of political and ecclesiastical or church life. Locke was initially attacked as an atheist, actually. One critic compared him to, one of his contemporaries, quote, one of those locusts that arose out of the smoke of the bottomless pit. I think I got into a discussion with Rob over there a while back, and he just referred to me as a locust from the bottomless pit. Rob, what was that about?
Joe, this is a scandal.
I can take it, man. I can take it. You can call me a locust anytime you want. Locust from the bottomless pit. Well, by the mid-18th century, Locke's combination of Christian piety, authentic faith, and natural rights. That combination is going to be sounded from pulpits on both sides of the Atlantic. And yet today, friends, back to our earlier point, today we hear Christian conservatives, some of them, rejecting liberal democracy with its emphasis on individual freedom. Listen to Patrick Deneen again of Notre Dame. Locke writes that the law works to increase liberty, Deneen says, by which he means, Locke means, our liberation from the constraints of the natural world. That's the name. Ronald Reno, over at the Catholic Journal, First Thing, says this, Locke's ideal society is a free association of individuals unbound by duties that transcend their choices. Unbound by duties that transcend their choices. These conservative critics, I think, steeped in a kind of nostalgia for the medieval world. They're blaming our modern social problems on the wicked, corrosive ideas of Lockean liberalism. So I'm going to ask them, I put these questions to them if they're in the room. Which ideas exactly? Which Lockean ideas are so corrosive and destructive? Is it the idea of human equality and human freedom based on the proposition that every person bears the image of God? Is it the idea that the rights of conscience are sacred and cannot be coerced by church or state? How about the idea that impartial justice, the golden rule, must be the cornerstone of any democratic society? Or how about the idea that the desire to know God and to find peace with God is inherent in every human soul, and that the state must respect this desire or forfeit its legitimacy? Are these the dangerous ideas that have shipwrecked our liberal order? No, friends, no. It was these concepts that helped the West to recover its Christian conscience. John Locke, the philosopher, the revolutionary, the reformer, he defended all of these ideas, all of them. The American Revolution was a Lockean revolution, and it still has the power to inspire. Writing in the New York Times, the Turkish columnist Mustafa Akgul, who's become a good friend of mine, Mustafa, in a nod to John Locke, offered in an op-ed, it was called A Letter Concerning Muslim Toleration, from Mustafa. Here's what he wrote. If Islamic thought is to liberalize today, he says, it must take a Lockean leap. Now more than ever, we need that Lockean leap, both at home and abroad. After living through decades of political and sectarian strife, after watching friends imprisoned, their lives destroyed, John Locke reached his radical conclusions. He's considered a modern thinker, but Locke helped to retrieve one of the gifts of historic Christianity, a narrative of grace and freedom that can defeat a culture of bigotry and oppression. Locke reminded us that every human heart whispers its desire for the mansions of the blessed, for a glimpse of that bright kingdom that lies beyond the sea. And in all of this, you look to the Bible, to Jesus, to the captain of our salvation, to the Prince of Peace, to help us to learn to live together in peace with justice. The Muslim world, as well as the West, could use another John Locke or someone like him this latest hour of crisis.